Welcome everyone to this Hopkins in Focus online research event. My name is Professor Tim Geraghty and I'll be your host for today's session. Before we go any further, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners on the land of the land on which we meet virtually today. My own work office here is in Brisbane on the land of the Yuggera people, and I would like to pay my respects to the elders past, present, and extend that respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. And we encourage all attendees to research the traditional owners of the land on which they live and work. So welcome once again to this event. Many of you have probably been involved in one or more of our Hopkins Centre Bold Ideas, Better Solutions Symposium, which we've held every year for the last three or four. But as many organisations have had to, we have had to move to an online experience, and we hope that that it will be an successful experience for you, and we hope that you're all doing well with the current challenges presented by COVID-19 and social distancing and remote workplaces, etc. So I am the Deputy Director of the Hopkins Centre and also the Medical Chair of the Division of Rehabilitation here at Princess Alexandra Hospital. I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to all of our Hopkins Centre partners and collaborators who are joining us here today, and to all attendees who are online virtually live streaming this event from all over Australia. We've had over 250 registrations today, and so hopefully we will get some great input, and I'm sure that the presentations will get you thinking and reflecting on what's happened over the past 6 or 9 months. We're very proud to partner with Cisco WebEx to bring this event to you today. And it really wouldn't be possible without their great support and sponsorship in providing this end-to-end online solution and collaboration. And as well as the Cisco partners, Teleca and VBRIC, who are also supporting the event and enabling us to produce this great virtual interactive experience. Just before we get into the presentations, just a couple of housekeeping items to draw your attention to. There is a closed caption capability in the VBRIC system, and the closed caption button is located on the bottom toolbar, the bottom right toolbar. And if you click that button, it will enable closed captions and then select English, and you'll be able to see subtitles underneath the live event if there is any problem with the audio where you are. Additionally, if you do have any technical difficulties during the event, please feel free to put a question in the Q&A section, and one of our event support team will try and assist you. Following each presentation, there'll be the opportunity for question and answers with each speaker, depending on available time. So if you can submit your questions into the Q&A section, and the Q&A button is found on the right-hand side of your screen, if you press the question mark icon button, the menu will appear. Today's Q&A sessions will be moderated by Brooke Wadsworth, a member of our Hopkins Research Leadership Team and part of today's online event support team. And so if you want to ask a question, just click enter your question and press the submit button. And your question will be published and viewable by the whole audience. Speakers will answer as many of those questions as they can during the time allowed, but if we don't get to all the questions, the speakers will be asked to answer the questions at the end of the session, and we'll make them available as part of the session wrap-up and a copy of the recording and each presentation will be available. We are recording this session, so if you have any technical trouble or need to leave, we'll distribute the full recording in coming days, and you'll be able to go back and have a look at any parts of the session that you missed. And also just a reminder that this is the first of three sessions that we're holding over the next couple of weeks in lieu of our normal face-to-face symposium. So each session will showcase a different perspective on disruption and adaptation in rehabilitation and designing resilient systems and responsive services, which is very current and important at this in 2020 as we deal with the impacts of the pandemic. So please, if you're interested in those other events, please register. In today's session, you'll hear practitioners' perspectives on the system and service disruption across the continuum of care. And this will highlight the experiences and ideas about how technology can solve problems and accelerate positive change in the delivery and design of rehabilitation. So, as you know, this session is called Practitioner Perspectives on System and Service Disruption, and I'd like to ask our first speaker, Dr. Ryan Bell, who's the Medical Director of the Brain Injury Rehabilitation Unit here at Princess Alexandra Hospital, Metro South Health, to present. And Ryan will be looking at some of the insights from rehab services and systems and frontline workers across the continuum of care into the community, and focusing on the opportunities for positive change in delivery and design of rehabilitation into the future. Thanks very much, Ryan. Over to you.
Right, thank you, Tim. I'm just going to share my screen here. Excellent. So please do let me know if there's any concerns seeing my presentation there or with the audio or the visual. So as Tim introduced me, the medical director of the Brain Rehabilitation Unit here at the PA Hospital as part of the wider Brain Injury Rehabilitation Service. So the scrolling through there, the title of my topic today is, as per the program, is really around service and system disruption, challenge and opportunities. And so, of course, I'll be looking at that really from the perspective of the Brain Injury Rehabilitation Service in 2020 in the current pandemic situation. Though I do suspect that many of these issues will apply to a broad range of rehabilitation settings. So a brief background on the Brain Injury Rehabilitation Service. We're a statewide specialty service for adults with acquired brain injury. We operate out of the Metro South HHS. And there's been quite a bit of expansion of the service continuum over the last 5 years, and this has really enabled greater access to the service and also a wider variety of rehabilitation pathways. You can see a model, I guess, of the BERS continuum there as patients or persons with an acquired brain injury move through the continuum, and our vision to empower people with an acquired brain injury to participate in life. So we all know that an acquired brain injury is often a life-changing event, but 2020 has forced us to examine what happens when life is also being disrupted at a global societal level. So the entire BERS service operates with a person and family-centred approach. So family and support people are encouraged to play a very active role in rehabilitation, from goal planning through to therapy sessions, transitions, and particularly discharge planning. And this has really been one of the major impacts of the pandemic on rehabilitation. Visitor restrictions and weekend leave restrictions have been particularly felt hard across inpatient services. We've had a loss of support for persons with acquired brain injury, more challenging adjustments to injury for both the person with acquired brain injury as well as their family. It's been quite difficult to obtain a holistic understanding of each patient's pre-injury function and what has changed since their injury. There's been some unique challenges with children unable to visit, and also partners and parents being unable to visit due to difficulties obtaining alternative care arrangements for the children. And the restrictions have frequently changed, so we've had to very rapidly communicate these changes with patients and families. And this has been particularly difficult as at times the PA hospital local policies have been stricter than those of the Queensland Chief Health Officer. Across our outpatient services, the restriction in attendance of support persons has been quite challenging, as well as the limited number of people permitted per treating or consulting room. And as you can imagine, in community services, the reduced ability to conduct home visits has really impacted a key contextual strength of this model of service. And within this patient-centred team, communication has been quite difficult at times. It's been challenged by social distancing, the need for masks, and overall a greater effort to meet as a team, which I think has increased the risk of clinician isolation and reduced team cohesion. Now, in terms of access, we've not just in BERS, but across the wider rehabilitation community, there have been many services that have reported reduced rehabilitation in patient beds, reduced access to gyms, office space, and consulting rooms, as these areas have been prepared for potential delivery of acute care. In fact, the very office I'm sitting in right now, I've been advised, can be rapidly converted into a PAN room should the need be. And amongst this group, we know that delayed access to rehab leads to poorer functional outcomes. We know poorer mental health and reduced quality of life often occur. Certainly within the BERS service, we've noted an increased number of patients who have really missed that opportunity for early intervention following concussion or mild traumatic brain injury through our day hospital. And beyond rehabilitation, more broadly in health, during periods of community transmission or perceived infection risk, there's been a reduced attendance to emergency departments, to general practice and outpatient clinics. And clearly this is going to impact chronic disease management, both primary prevention, secondary prevention, and functional deterioration of existing conditions. Access has also been limited due to social distancing requirements in clinics and group programs. So peer learning, therapy delivery, and education, such as communication partner training, has been affected. Now, we know support networks, of course, become increasingly important in maintaining people in the community following a rehabilitation intervention. And we've certainly seen diminished avenues to build and maintain formal and informal support networks around people with acquired brain injury. Now, I should say an exception to this was a very swift increase in responsiveness of both NDIS and also the Office of the Public Guardian in working with health to progress some very complex hospital discharge plans. This, along with a trend towards earlier discharge from hospital, has substantially increased demand on transitional and community services. As part of the BERS continuum, the Acquired Brain Injury Outreach Service has certainly seen an increased demand for rehabilitation coordination or clinical case management, which has then impacted their ability to deliver rehabilitation-specific interventions, training, and consultancy. We've also seen the closure of many community facilities, such as community centres, libraries, hydrotherapy pools. And the STEPS, Skills to Enable People in Communities, Self-Management Skills Program and Program Leader Training, which have a tremendous reach across Queensland. So far, this year, they've had to cancel programs in Cairns, Bundaberg, Toowoomba, Kingaroy, and 5 programs across the greater Brisbane area. So in addition to service delivery issues, as discussed, there's a significant impact on healthcare providers. There's apprehension amongst potentially vulnerable staff members. There's the social distancing challenges when housing staff in existing clinical spaces. There's increased absenteeism with illness, which is of course though far preferred than presenteeism, and a wider impact on mental health and pandemic fatigue. Planning has been disrupted as a large amount of time and resources has been used to plan for potential surges in the need for acute service demand. And this has really come at the expense of planning and improvement expansion of rehabilitation services. There's been a lot of planning done at management levels for how to cope with staff quarantining, backfill, and staff redeployment. And the current and anticipated ongoing economic disruption is likely to interfere with funding sustainability and growth opportunities. A lot of study recruitment and data collection has been paused, and there have of course been impacts on professional development and student education. So, interestingly enough, despite the impact of the pandemic on health and society at large, it was really encouraging last week to hear at the Queensland Statewide Rehabilitation Clinical Network Forum that the AROC rehabilitation outcomes have actually been maintained. And I think this really is a credit and reflects the invention and innovation of rehabilitation services. Despite this, the necessity will persist. Despite our promising situation here in Queensland, as the world passes 40 million cases and many countries resume quite severe lockdowns, that necessity to drive innovation and invention will continue. As a health system, we're getting better at treating acute COVID-19. Beyond that initial focus on respiratory support through to reducing the mortality associated with the multi-organ dysfunction. So survival rates are increasing, which will then inevitably mean a greater need for rehabilitation intervention. There's also another group of patients who experience quite mild COVID-19 illness initially, but subsequently experience major sequelae such as stroke, neuropathy, or pulmonary fibrosis. And as I alluded to before, there's also the indirect effects of COVID on chronic disease management. So there is anticipated in coming months and years to be greater incidence of stroke, amputation, falls, fractures, and deconditioning, all requiring rehabilitation intervention. So technology, it's not the one and only answer to the current system and service disruption, but it's clearly one of the key tools at our disposal. The integrated electronic medical record in most Queensland public hospitals was already very effective pre-pandemic, and its value has increased exponentially. It's facilitated remote clinician access, it's enhanced communication within teams, it's improved communication across clinical services and even between hospitals. Within the brain injury rehabilitation service, we underwent rapid conversion to between 40 to 100% telehealth use for our encounters across outpatient and community services. Now, of course, challenges remain. There are some clinical services that are suboptimal when not delivered face-to-face. There's challenges with access to technology for both patients and clinicians, equipment access, bandwidth, particularly for our regional, rural and remote patients. And there's difficulties navigating online systems and online models for patients with severe physical, cognitive, sensory or communication impairments. But there is still, of course, some key advantages. There's reduced travel time and costs for both patients and clinicians. There's the opportunity to provide contextual relevance of assessments of the person in their own home environment. And we've certainly found in our day hospital service that our failure to attend rate has reduced when we've been able to utilise telehealth, though this is more found with telephone rather than video conferencing. So the rapidly changing healthcare system has increased, I think, clinician and executive acceptance of reviews of existing models of care. There's definitely a favour towards flexible service delivery, including accommodating alternative working arrangements for staff. And I think a lot of this has helped promote a shift from multidisciplinary to inter or transdisciplinary models. Clearly, there's a important need and a great desire for earlier coordinated rehabilitation interventions during acute care. And there needs to be greater preparedness for transitions into and between rehabilitation services, and far higher capacity in the community rehabilitation service sector to cope with the demands of early hospital discharge. This will happen during the pandemic and I'm sure well beyond. So from our, I guess, fortunate position in Queensland at the moment, we do have the opportunity to learn from rehabilitation colleagues, both interstate and internationally, so that we can prepare for what is optimal post-COVID rehabilitation. And on the top right of the slide there is the British Society of Rehabilitation Medicine post-COVID rehabilitation pathway. We can also learn about the impacts of comorbid COVID when someone is rehabilitating for another primary disability, as well as learning about the impacts of comorbid COVID on an existing disability. There's also pleasingly emerging evidence which we can learn from and contribute to for virtual rehabilitation, both its clinical effectiveness as well as some operational solutions. And certainly there are a number of studies published across TBI, stroke, cardiac and cancer rehabilitation. And finally, there's also the opportunity for us to challenge the funding discrepancies that exist between delivering rehabilitation therapy by telehealth compared to face-to-face. And if we can get this right, this will increase the long-term sustainability of this virtual model. So look, I'll end there at that point, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Hello. Ryan, thank you very much for providing that really comprehensive presentation on the impact that the last, just slightly more than 6 months has had on the services here. We have a chance to take a few questions. So thank you everyone for using the question and answer function. I think there's one question that's come through regarding what were the enablers to allow the rapid increase in the use of telehealth in the outpatient services in your experience?
So certainly we had, I think, patients and the public were very prepared for a transition to telehealth. That often would fit in with their desire for hospital avoidance. There's certainly obviously been increase in general availability and access to technology amongst patients and the public over the last number of years. And certainly, I think a key cog in our tool has been the use of our administrative staff really helping to drive the setup of the actual platforms, working with IT in Queensland Health, that being progressed much more rapidly, some flexibility around what services we could use, and a lot of the education of not just patients but also clinicians in using telehealth by our administration officers. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the access to computers and also just upskilling staff is obviously always going to be the challenge when it has to happen quickly. Is it something that you will likely to continue to utilise going forward?
Yeah, and we have. We've flexed up and down the proportion of telehealth or versus face-to-face in line with COVID restrictions and patient preference. One thing that we've clearly seen is that this is a very valid alternative, particularly for some of our review appointments with patients, those that live regionally, rurally or remotely, so they can still maintain that long-term access with a specialist service without, the tyranny of distance and travel.
So we haven't got any other questions at the moment from the audience, but if you're thinking of questions for Ryan as we go through the other presentations, certainly put it up in the question and answer function, and those will get through to Ryan. He can answer them in time. But now I'd like to thank Ryan for that presentation, and I'll allow him to sign off.
Thank you.
We are moving on to our next presenter, and it is Dr. Stephen Peterson. So Dr. Steve is a GP, a general practitioner for New South Wales Health Virtual Rural Generalist Service, and I had the pleasure of meeting Steve shortly after he experienced a time in hospital, and I've also met him on several occasions since. He's going to present on the everyday experience of community healthcare, system disruption, and adaptive responses during the 2020 pandemic health crisis. I'll hand over to Steve.
G'day, my name is Steve Peterson. I'm a GP from Orange in New South Wales, and I've been asked to give a brief talk on the impact on general practice of the 2020 pandemic. So yes, it was a unusual, fluid, uncertain situation this year as the whole country and its health systems dealt with something that is very rare and has never really happened before in this way. Having said that, unusual should be the usual in GP. We say that uncommon presentations of common conditions are much more common than common presentations of uncommon conditions. Even though, yep, the 2020 coronavirus was a particularly snafu year, and it did have a lot of impacts that people had to adjust with, I could talk for a long time on those. Three in particular that were worth mentioning was the new telehealth item numbers, the new roles that GPs found themselves doing, and the impact of the coronavirus on training and exams. So, much of GP is enumerated through telehealth item numbers through the MBS. And from March, there were in the introduction of teleconference and phone item numbers for the first time ever. It was the same enumeration as a face-to-face consult, so no particular disadvantage for doing that. There were lots of different types. The normal consultations, care plans, mental health, there were various item numbers available for other medical specialists and allied health. Now, these were adjusted in the middle of the year. They were adjusted that you could only bill that item number if you'd actually met the patient face-to-face in the previous year. It was also adjusted to allow for private billing of these item numbers that in the past could only be done in a bulk billed manner. And then they were adjusted again in the end of the year for another 6 months. So big changes, changes that GPs had been asking for a long time. And how did we have to adjust for those? Well, they were popular. They were popular for doctors and for patients. Patients quite liked having to just receive a phone call rather than having to drive all the way in, sit in the waiting room, presumably get exposed to coronavirus, then go in, see the doctor, come out, pay, and then leave. So patients were quite keen for it. It allowed for previously unpaid work to be remunerated. If we had to call a patient for a result or to speak to them about something that was going on, that would normally just be something the doctor would do and not accept. I'm not expect any money for, and I personally think that was covered by the consultation fee that you charged when you first saw the patient. But now these things could be done. This was very helpful for rural patients as well. I live in country New South Wales, so people being able to speak to their specialist over the phone rather than have to drive all the way to Sydney and back for a 15-minute appointment was great. And for the fail to attends, the people that just didn't turn up for their appointment, which normally would be a waste of time, but this time if you give them a call, find out why. So that was good. It did provide an opportunity for the telehealth-only services, things like Instant Consult and Quokka. They existed before the pandemic as a fee for service. They were obviously quite happy when telehealth item numbers came into play. And I think the restrictions to force you to have that face-to-face contact was a way to kind of stop those sort of providers from taking over as the main mode of care. They wanted that link to a GP practice, a bricks and mortar practice, to still remain. So there were some challenges for this. Initially, it could only be bulk billed, and the patients obviously quite enjoyed that. Some practices work on a private billing model where they expect a payment for services, and found it was that was difficult because patients weren't particularly happy with that, and they had to make implications to what they decided to charge. The technology was not provided. We had to figure that one out ourselves. And well, some were better than others in terms of how well they could be used and the risks of privacy breaches. Medico-legally, telehealth has always been covered. It'll be interesting to see what changes in terms of premiums and restrictions given now that telehealth is quite more widespread, because not all consultations can be safely done over the computer. Sometimes it's not particularly obvious until the consultation is underway. So doctors would have to adjust to make sure they've got some sort of backup plan to see a patient face to face if it becomes apparent the service can't be delivered in a safe manner. And there was an impact on restrictions excluding some services. For instance, there was quite a reduction, about a third of the normal breast screens for mammograms for breast cancer performed this year. So one wonders if down the line we're going to have, say, increased rates of breast cancer because of the reduction in screening that was done because of the change associated with coronavirus. So doctors found themselves doing a new job. Undifferentiated, unwell people present to a GP, that's normal. But at the start of this pandemic, we were not particularly sure how serious this was going to be. And, you know, that affected doctors in a variety of ways. The other work still had to continue. The other medical things we had to do did continue, and sometimes that would be impeded by isolation, such as the breast screening that I talked about before. Some work became more common. You know, mental health presentations certainly went up. A lot of occupational and work-related problems went down because less people were working. And, you know, there were some GPs as well that probably found their own mental health a little bit challenged. Some doctors became much busier and others became much quieter because people just weren't going out of the house for much at all, and that included seeing the doctor. So adjusting to these things, well, we have to be flexible, and that's just again, part of general practice, I think. There were physical modifications to a practice that had to be done in terms of waiting room management. We didn't want lots of sick people in a room together, spreading stuff around. People were often screened in the car park, and if you had respiratory system symptoms, you might find yourself entering via the back door of the practice and going to the one room with the one doctor who's doing that today and not having contact with other people. So that was obviously quite individual. Each practice had to decide what they were going to do and make that challenge. They had to integrate with local testing regimes, which again would be unique to a geographical area, and deal with the much more frequent communication from the GP college, which would normally be happily ignored. But with the virus going on, suddenly it became things we were interested in hearing. Now, I finally wanted to mention about doctor training for general practice and how the coronavirus impacted trainee registrars. This is an important issue, as the registrars were a key part of the medical system, particularly in rural areas, as half of all registrar positions are in rural areas, a way for the government to try to deal with the doctor shortage out this way. And they found themselves disrupted. Often their hospital training, which they had to do before coming on to our practice, was disrupted, and the terms they might have had to do before they were allowed to go do general practice were just not being done because either elective surgery wasn't being done or people being redeployed to various coronavirus stuff. And there were problems with examinations, which I'll talk about in a minute. So how to adjust to this? Well, workforce was an issue. Some of the rural registrars had family elsewhere in interstate, and I certainly had one that just did a mad dash to Queensland before the borders closed because that's where his family was, and that was just it. He just wasn't around anymore. So we had to make sure that we could cover what we could and deal with what we couldn't. A lot of registrars needed their training time extended, which, again, they probably didn't like that much. It's more time as a trainee, but if they weren't getting their exams or terms done, there wasn't much we could do about that. Examinations were done online. That was both good and bad. The written exam was a bit of a train wreck. The exam basically didn't work. We had to stop it halfway through. We were getting kicked off or couldn't log on, or bits were crashing. And it was a real mess, which is a real shame for the 1,400 registrars that had spent quite a bit of money each to sit the exam. Fortunately, the practical exam, which I was more involved with, and finishes up on Thursday. And so far, it's going pretty well. Basically, we're doing lots of consultation practice, I suppose, over Zoom and marking people that way. So certainly major modifications, but so far seems to be working and adjusting well. So yeah, it was an unusual year. It was an unusual year for professions, and general practice was part of that as well. Certainly gave us many of challenges that we've had to adjust to. Amongst them were new Medicare, item numbers, new roles and responsibilities, and impacts of training, and look, general practice is always exciting. We will see what 2020 or 2021 now has in store.
Oh, thank you very much, Dr. Steve Peterson from Orange in New South Wales. That was very informative to see the experiences you had in the community. Today, we don't have time for some questions for Steve, but if you pop your questions up that you might have, we will get them to Dr. Peterson and he'll get back to us in time and we'll get the responses to you. So we'll move on to our next presenter. And our next presenter is Associate Professor Dave Trembath. David is a speech pathologist and he is with the Hopkins Centre. He's a Deputy Research Director at the Hopkins Centre and an Advanced Queensland Fellow. And the Hopkins Centre, as you know, is through the Menzies Health Institute in Queensland and Griffith University. He is going to present today A Decade of Change in Days, Building More Responsive and Resilient Services for Individuals with Developmental Disabilities and Their Families. So welcome, David.
Thank you very much, Brooke. I'll share my screen. And thank you very much, everyone, for the opportunity to present this afternoon. So I am going to reflect on what has been an amazing transition in the field of lifelong disability for individuals with disability and their families. And just picking up on Steve's presentation and Ryan's before that, you know, we're hearing about these personal experiences of clinicians and, you know, going through this process and those in the health services. What I'd like to do is just share some glimpses from the field of developmental disability, particularly from the perspective of individuals and their families. I'd like to start by acknowledging Dr. Rebecca Sutherland, who's based at the University of Canberra, whose PhD focused on the telehealth delivery of language assessments for children on the autism spectrum, and Professor Jacqueline Roberts, who was a collaborator on that project. I'd also like to acknowledge Autism Queensland, that is a key partner organisation with the Hopkins Centre in relation to work in this area, and I'll talk a little bit more about that shortly. We have in Australia a community that is clearly looking for bold ideas and better solutions when it comes to accessing services, equitable, effective services for all. We have, in this presentation, I'd like to focus on people on the autism spectrum in particular, of whom there are 160,000 in Australia. These individuals have a lifelong disability that impacts their learning and their participation, their access to all of the opportunities that many of us just get to take for granted. The magnitude of the need is evidenced by substantial investment through the NDIS in support packages for individuals, which on average at the moment around $40,000 per annum. We also have here a community that is already very much disadvantaged by distance and was prior to the pandemic. If we just look at Queensland, for example, we're seeing that over 1 in 10 people are living in a location where there's a population of less than 15,000. And while it's not a direct correlation, generally, if you live in a place with a smaller population, you have fewer choices when it comes to services. And the distance also creates substantial challenges for the service providers looking to reach a broader population. About 4,500 people services are registered in Queensland alone, providing services through the NDIS. So there's a huge population of people seeking support, people seeking to provide good support, who are trying to make the most of this situation. Within this context, telehealth has long been considered a promising solution. The idea that people can connect using various telecommunications technology, both bespoke and off the shelf, for clinicians to connect with clients and clinicians to connect with colleagues in order to provide the services we need and to move the field forward. forward and support one another. In our area of autism, Rebecca, Jackie and myself completed a systematic review to try to understand what are the services that are being provided and what is the evidence for the effectiveness and the feasibility of these types of approaches. So back in 2018, we published this systematic review, in which we identified 14 studies looking at 284 participants from young children right through to adults. And we found that a range of services had been provided. There are attempts to do this in a number of populations, from diagnostic assessments through to early intervention services, services to support people with anxiety and to provide assessments and support for people requiring behaviour support. The findings were fairly consistent. The telehealth was generally equivalent to face-to-face delivery for these services and certainly superior when no alternative service was available. But to understand this and to dig down further, we looked at a particular aspect of this type of service delivery. We asked the question, can language assessments delivered via telehealth be used reliably and feasibly? Are they reliable and feasible for individuals on the autism spectrum? Here, 13 children and their families participated, and we had a speech pathologist deliver the assessments via telehealth to children in a remote location with another speech pathologist sitting in the same room. And we looked at the extent to which the scores on each of those assessments for those two people providing assessments, to what extent did they correlate? And then what did the families think about their experience with the service? In terms of the reliability, if we look at those correlations there and we look at the different subtests in the language assessment, there was a very strong correlation. Yes, they were reliable in this instance from a scoring perspective. And when we look at the comments from families, we see a mixture of experiences. And very positive, and you know, he loves computers, participant one, and telephoning friends, so this was a great fit. Through to people finding challenges with the technology or the delivery, for example, participant seven with the poor audio. And perhaps this just captures the essence of the challenge with telehealth delivery in many ways. But what did it look like when, through the pandemic and the consequences of that, we did see literally a decade of change in days in this field? Some insights from a few of different organisations. In terms of our partner organisation, Autism Queensland, it's a lead agency providing services in Queensland. They worked with 3,500 individuals and their families last year. 300 staff involved in this organisation. They transitioned over half of their clients to telehealth within a matter of weeks. And in this story published in the Brisbane Times, Pam McCrossan, CEO, talks about the fact that they were looking at this approach in the lead up to the pandemic to manage wait lists. And what they actually did was bring this work forward substantially in terms of time. I've gone through and looked for other examples of people's individual experiences. Here, David Moody, CEO of the National Disability Services, talks about the fact that there's been some really positive outcomes from telehealth. Many clients and their supporters and families are actually coming to telehealth as being a preferred model of service delivery. But on the other side of things, we see parents saying it's a real struggle for some children and their families. My son can't do therapy or school through a laptop. He needs to have for him to access telehealth, he needs someone sitting there right beside him. So there's an assumption that me and my wife could do that with him during those sessions, but we just can't. In a study out of Macquarie University, they looked at people's experiences. Izzy Oz, a young woman with autism, talked about the fact that accessing psychology services wasn't quite the same when delivered via telehealth. It further reduced my feeling of support and my ability to helpfully vent what was happening and get those extra skills and help in time, and I probably needed it more, she said. Ebony Whitehouse, a parent of a young child on the autism spectrum, talked about her anxiety about him starting school next year because normally they'd be doing a series of visits to help make that transition as smooth as possible. But again, on the other side, there's a suggestion that the experiences of telehealth and pandemic more broadly actually helped to kind of crush some of the myths that are around autism including the notion that all people on the autism spectrum want isolation, would actually be in their element, if you like, during a pandemic situation. As Melanie Hayworth said, autistic people, just like everybody else, need connection, community and friends. Finally, an insight in terms of the implications of all of this. Paige Armstrong, Chief Executive of Queensland's Disability Network, talked about the fact that access to technology, to computers, etc., being just as vital as power, water, and other essential services during the pandemic. So I've shared personal insights, anecdotes, if you like. What we're going to do now in a project supported by the Queensland Government through an Advanced Queensland Fellowship and supported by partner Autism Queensland is really work to understand what has worked and what has not worked, to identify and extend the most effective models, not only to build resilience into the system, but also to reach all of those individuals and families who seek telehealth services in regional and remote areas. We're going to work to do so in a way that ensures that policy, higher education, workforce development are aligned with community expectations around now the right to access services in this way. And most importantly, we're going to do so in a way that learns from and enables the experts, that is people with lived experience of disability, to be core members in the team, members of the team, as we go about this through a co-design process. So thank you for allowing me to share a few insights, and I look forward to sharing progress on the research as it unfolds from here.
Oh, thank you very much, David. That was really interesting talk, and I'm really interested in that advanced fellow study that you're embarking on. I think it's very, very valuable. So we do have a question. Thank you for putting the questions forward, audience. Keep them coming. A question for you, David. In the presentation, you spoke about the importance of co-designing solutions with individuals on the autism spectrum. Can you give us some practical examples of what this might involve?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Brooke. A couple of examples. So the Autism CRC, an organisation that brings together a range of organisations across Australia, has worked with autistic adults, using identity first language deliberately there, to develop a set of guidelines that are all around co-design and co-production of research. So we'll work from those guidelines, but at a further more practical level, what we'll do is we have a project team that is actually going to be comprised of people bringing a range of perspectives, including those living with autism on the autism spectrum. And what we really want to do here as well is to tap into, not just from a project point of view, how to understand these issues and come up with better solutions, but what's been revealed there are, so far, is that it's been some of the solutions that individuals on the autism spectrum themselves have proposed for service delivery models in telehealth that have been the most successful. So we really want to tap into not just project expertise and perspective and so on, which is critical, but we actually really even more so want to tap into those practical ideas people have making services that best fit their individual needs and preferences.
And may I ask over what time frame this study will be carried out?
Yeah, so we'll be commencing in January. It'll run for 18 months, and it will include both within Autism Queensland, working to understand the issues, developing a practice portal, and holding a series of free webinars and other information sessions and so on over that period. So we really want to share everything that we learned from that process and to be shaped and influenced by the learnings from people all over Queensland and in the country. In fact, so if people would like to understand more about it, please connect and we'll make sure that you hear about all of those opportunities.
Wonderful. Thank you, David. And if there are any other questions in the audience out there that come to mind during the rest of the presentations, certainly pop them up and we'll get them through to David. But thank you very much, David, for presenting today. The next speaker I would like to introduce is Ms. Kylie Pursehouse, who is the co-chair of the Statewide Rehab Clinical Network. And Kylie is going to present on the impacts on and adaptations made by rehabilitation services during the pandemic from the perspective of the Statewide Rehab Clinical Network in Queensland. So thanks very much, Kylie. I'll leave it to you.
Great. Thank you, Book. Thank you very much for the introduction. I'll just share my slides with you all. Hopefully you can see those now. So thank you very much for the opportunity to talk about the impacts on and the adaptations that have been made by rehabilitation services during the pandemic from the perspective of the Statewide Rehabilitation Clinical Network. I think we've heard from the previous speakers that for the last 9 to 10 months, it certainly has been a time of upheaval for everyone. And for rehabilitation, our teams and our people, it's been no different. So today I'll reflect on the way rehab teams have responded to the challenges, the adaptations we've made and are still making, and the opportunity that is provided by technology, particularly in the way we connect and deliver services to make the most of these new ways of doing things. I think it has been a silver lining of the pandemic that the network has had to clearly say what rehabilitation is and to explain its value in the health and social care system. And that's been particularly for those outside of rehab. So Professor Derek Wade has been helpful in articles that he's published this year, articulating an evidence-based approach to rehabilitation. And these have informed what we mean when the network talks about rehabilitation. So rehab is the provision of interventions, almost always in a biopsychosocial framework, with the aim of reducing continuing disability from illness or injury. So if you're not familiar with networks, statewide clinical networks are a key initiative of Clinical Excellence Queensland to engage clinicians and consumers in decision-making about clinical services and practice improvements. So to give you my translation, in rehab, we know the importance of teams. Networks are just big teams, engaging, partnering, and collaborating to make a better healthcare system. So the rehab network, it's primarily made up of clinicians, and we seek to represent them and key partners, such as our consumers, through our steering committee. And through our collective efforts, we aim to strengthen the communication and visibility of rehab services, what they are doing and achieving for Queenslanders. So I might have seen this hypothetical model of the health footprint of the pandemic or various iterations of it. I first saw it circulated on Twitter quite early on, and it was a prompt for planning and thinking about impacts, some of which we've heard of from Ryan earlier today. So the representation of waves here illustrates the potential collateral damage of COVID-19 for everyone, so not just those who contract COVID-19. So the consequences of delayed or interrupted health and rehabilitation care and the impact of social isolation on our health and wellbeing. So thankfully in Queensland, we haven't seen the large numbers of people with COVID-19, but we've certainly felt the impact of the planning response on rehabilitation services. So in April, we did a very quick ask of the network to tell us about the impact of COVID-19 and what was happening for them. And it gave us a snapshot of the range of people's experiences at that time. So we heard about what changed, and you've heard this already this afternoon. People talked about how social distancing and infection control guidelines had changed the way we used our rehab spaces, such as gyms and kitchens, how clinical interventions such as group programs and those needing clinical physical contact had to change, and the sense of isolation that distancing created for some people. We also heard how increasing acute hospital surge capacity resulted in early discharge from rehab, some units completely emptied or relocated to other facilities, and the changes to workloads. And this included a shift to community delivery, but not necessarily an equivalent shift in community resourcing. So how did we respond? Well, like other areas, rehab clinicians adapted. Capacity challenges are not new for us. We have had a number, we've never really had the number of rehab beds or community services we would like. And similarly, the dispersed nature of the Queensland population that David alluded to, the cost and burden of travel, these are not new problems. The big response that people commented on was the rapid increase in the use of technology. So did it work for rehabilitation teams and the people we work with? Well, in our survey, we got positive feedback as well as feedback on the challenges of technology. Its unpredictability, the lack of equipment like webcams, and a lack of training and confidence for both patients and clinicians. Some people also commented on their feelings around change for both patients, I guess around the loss of traditional in-person methods and anxiety around delivering optimal outcomes. So what might we miss because we can't do things in the traditional way? And we also heard about the loss of trust, which has also been mentioned today, on the part of consumers in the safety of health services. So people wanting to stay away from hospitals and not have health workers visit their homes. And we're still in that process of rebuilding that trust. So in quickly shifting the way we delivered rehabilitation, there certainly was a dizzying amount of pivoting, and technology was a big part of that pivot. In rehab, we might talk about broadly three categories of technology: therapeutic, assistive, communication. And the pandemic has seen the rise of communication technology. And as we've heard, this isn't necessarily new technology. We've been making Skype calls well over a decade. There are many examples in health and rehabilitation where we've delivered services using communication technologies. Certainly the focus now is on video. But services have been using phone and email and messaging to communicate and exchange information for many years. So there's nothing like a personal anecdote to illustrate the big picture. So I'd like to tell you a story of my mum, who has undergone 8 weeks of pre-rehab for elective orthopaedic surgery, and she's just entered her 8-week post-surgery rehab. She lives in regional Queensland with my dad and their dog, Turner. Now, mum's rehab has involved being supplied with wearable technology. She was sent an activity tracker and an iPad, and she gets regular updates on her goals by text messages. She also has twice a week visits, and these are by video, with her physiotherapist. So whilst my dad provided me with the photo on the right to illustrate the kit, I am assured that Turner never wore the activity tracker to boost mum's steps. So as the rehab clinicians who did our quick survey flagged, digital technology provides many benefits: greater flexibility, better availability of time, don't have to wait for that window of a hospital appointment. For my mum, it was certainly more convenient to do her program at home. And even though she's only a short drive to the local hospital, she certainly told me it was a hassle to get a park. But clearly there are barriers when we don't have the equipment or the skills required, both for clinicians and consumers. So what important things might we be missing when we can't deliver rehab in person? And it's certainly not only in health and rehabilitation that COVID-19, the pandemic, has accelerated the pace of everyday activities moving online. And it's increasingly critical that all Australians are digitally included so they can participate in all aspects of society. So in this just released roadmap from the Australian Digital Inclusion Alliance, they've described what being digitally included means. So a person has affordable access to high quality internet. They own the appropriate devices to utilise the internet. A person can use the internet in an accessible way. So whether they're living with a disability, they're from a culturally or linguistically diverse background, or with other needs. And a person has the skills and the confidence to complete tasks on and benefit from the internet. So as my dad demonstrates, he's got the skills, he photoshops, we email, we do regular family video chats. And he has the access, he's got devices and he's connected to the internet. But he certainly thinks his internet could be way more affordable. So in the last fortnight, I read a blog from the King's Fund, an uncomfortable truth. Digital isn't perfect, but neither is face-to-face. And I think thinking about technology and COVID-19, the author has summed up some of the things we've been discussing at the network and some of the things that the other speakers have raised today. I think we all recognise that much of the digital transformation is here to stay. We want to be able to provide the best quality rehabilitation service that doesn't exacerbate or create new inequalities. But quality means different things to rehab clinicians, to patients, and their supports. So focusing just on clinical indicators alone will ignore other factors like convenience, ease of access, flexibility, the cost, and those, I guess, many other factors that are important to people's experience of rehabilitation and the outcomes that matter to them. So the quality of rehabilitation delivered by a communication technology, it can certainly be improved. And I think this is by a combination of training and making the best use of its capabilities. The new ways, I guess, of doing things are important, but they should be considered alongside traditional rehabilitation care. So not instead of, not a substitution. And we need to evaluate to ensure that the pace of change brings clinicians and consumers on board. So when we're comfortable with all the options for delivering rehabilitation, whether that's via video, by telephone, by in person, when they all feel second nature, then I think we'll know that the communication technology has arrived. So I wanted to thank you for inviting me to your place for a chat. Before I head out, I wanted to acknowledge my Rehabilitation Network co-chair, Alyssa Farrow, our network coordinator, Rachel Olorencio, our steering committee, and all members of the network. So thank you. I'll just stop sharing my screen.
Thank you very much, Kylie. That was great. I love the personal story as well to make it really relatable to everyone, really. So we have time for a few questions. There's one question that's come through for you, Kylie. As a rehab professional, I felt worried rehab clients might miss out during the pandemic and that this might create negative outcomes for them in the long term. Do you think the importance of rehab is fully understood?
Thank you, Brooke. I think, you know, just in the last week, Ryan mentioned we had our network's first forum, and that was by video, and that was in conjunction with the Allied Health Professional Office of Queensland and the Hopkins Centre. And the discussion at that forum certainly highlighted that clinicians felt that the value of rehab wasn't understood by all. You know, that maybe as rehab clinicians, we're hiding our light under a bushel, that we have a really important and essential role in the health system. You know, it's not just a luxury add-on. So I think, you know, one of the things that we've done as a network is that we have put forward a couple of briefs to the Queensland Health's pandemic response planning group, and that's to advocate and really increase the visibility of rehab to the system. And we did get positive feedback about those briefs, but I think it's really an ongoing conversation that the Rehab Network will continue to lead so that rehab is consistently included in statewide planning, not just in response to COVID-19, but really for the future. It's a really important part of the overall system.
Yeah, I agree. I think the change that occurred in the IT literacy that was required for the patient in rehab that had no experience from before was the real issue. And things like the community services, like council libraries that often ran the free education sessions and orientation for people to use iPads and computers and connect and share all those things, people couldn't react to them or be involved in them because of things getting shut down so quickly. So I think people have had to learn very, very quickly on their feet or not on their feet.
Yes. But I think as it was mentioned, it is surprising the number of people who've got some, you know, improved access to devices, or they're more familiar than we perhaps expect.
Okay, thank you very much, Kylie, for presenting to us today. I'm going to move on to our next speaker, which is Dr. Camilla Shirota. Camilla is an Advanced Queensland Research Fellow and a research lead for Habitech, the Habitech Project, part of the Hopkins Centre. And Camilla is going to present today a presentation titled Opportunities to Innovate and Accelerate Use of Technology Across All Phases of Rehabilitation. So I'll leave it to you, Camilla.
Thank you, Brooke, for that. I'm just going to share my screen. There we go. Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. Sorry. Thanks for joining us today. As Brooke said, my name's Camilla, and I am going to switch gears just a little bit from our previous talks because, unlike our previous speakers who are practitioners from the clinical or medical side of things, I am an engineer by training. So I look at the situation in a little bit of a different light. So I don't think. I think it's pretty clear from what we've heard today that COVID-19 had a really big impact in medical services, but in rehabilitation in particular. And this has been a reflection of not only what happened here in Australia, but actually also worldwide. We've seen a loss of inpatient beds, services had to be relocated. Some of them were closed, especially in other parts of the world where COVID hit a lot harder. And services were sometimes had to give their space, their equipment, and even their people up to take care of COVID patients. And across the board, what we saw is that these the social distancing measures had a really big impact in the ability of our clinicians to deliver the services that are needed, especially when you think about the disciplines that rely on physical contact. So we've also heard today about how clinicians and clinical services were able to innovate and be very resourceful and continue delivering a lot of services that are critical. But what we have to think about is how can we make all of this, the entire system, become more resilient? And one of the things that we think could help is technology, which, again, is not completely new because a few of our speakers have talked about that already. And here we have just a handful of examples of technology that has been developed for rehabilitation. These devices are all medically certified and they're commercially available, meaning you can buy them. But the issue is, even though they've been around for quite a while, we know that they're not that commonly seen inside of clinical settings or even in the hands of end users. So what can we do to help accelerate their uptake? And one of the inspirations is telehealth. I'm the first person to talk about telehealth today, but this perspective that I want to bring is that telehealth actually is inspirational, but it's also a cautionary tale because it's been around since the 1960s. So image-based telemedicine has been around since the 1960s, and it was only really uptaken widespread this year. And what we saw happen was that barriers, and many of which were cited earlier today in other presentations, they have been around for decades. And only this year, in the context of the pandemic, have some of these barriers been overcome or circumvented. So we want to be able to look at an example like telehealth and make sure that these new technologies that are coming out for rehab don't get stuck in the same place. And image-based telemedicine, for example, can do a lot of things like enable face-to-face consultations, but at a distance. But we kind of want to think about also if we have this opportunity to go beyond and think about other things that we would like to do that technology enable us to do. So rethinking about rehabilitation. And one example is movement tracking, like Kylie mentioned today. One of the issues in rehabilitation has been for a long time is that we don't have a very good understanding of what clinicians see in the clinic, how well that transfer into patients' daily lives. So nowadays we have movement trackers This one, for example, you just wear it on your shoe. And these trackers can provide some performance data to therapists, as you can see on the two screens on your right. And not only that, it can also enable the patient to have access to their own data so that they can also follow their own recovery. Another area where we could also innovate is when you want people to independently be able to live on their own in a safe manner. This system here, it consists of some monitors, which are the little M's there. And what they do is they track the person inside of their house, their movements. There's some artificial intelligence behind it that learns what the movement patterns or the habits of the person are. And if the person changes those patterns, you have the ability to communicate with the person. There are speakers inside of the house, or it can automatically trigger an alert and call for external help. Another example of where we're trying to innovate as well is being able to get precise measures based off of images. So one issue that we always have is being able to make precise measurements in a manner that's very easy and not very expensive. We have very expensive, very precise devices, but they tend to be very hard to use and then very time consuming. And so there are lots of researchers working on systems such as this one, where you can use a regular video camera. Just powered by some really smart computer algorithms, and they do a pretty good job of reconstructing the movement. And then based off of that, you can kind of measure, take out measurements that are useful clinically. Another issue that was kind of mentioned today is also, you know, even if you have a multitude of different devices that you have access to, for example, this whole suite illustrated here, if these machines don't talk to each other, so being able to track what a single patient does in lots of different devices and being able to access that from electronic medical records, for example, so that all the information for a single patient is accessible from a single location is also very important and very useful for practical clinical applications. And so really, I could keep on going and talk for a really long time and still not be able to cover, you know, all of the areas of rehabilitation. There's a lot of specialties and aspects that I could talk about. But really, what I want to highlight is, you know, how do we go beyond and try to solve all these problems? And a lot of what we see still, unfortunately, our engineers or developers looking at clinicians and asking them, what do you want? And clinicians looking back to engineers and developers saying, what can you do? And we kind of get stuck in this separated world where we're both looking at each other and kind of frozen, waiting for the other one to say something. So what we're trying to do at Habitech is do a better job of co-developing and co-producing solutions that clinicians come up or of clinicians that are identified by clinicians and that engineers and developers can help identify the best ways to solve those problems. And of course, we also need to recognize, based on what we've heard today also, is that there are lots of other stakeholders in the process, people with disability, of course, first and foremost, but you have insurers because these technologies need to be paid for. You have managers because these devices need to be integrated inside of the work kind of line of work that the clinicians need to do, designers and scientists to make sure that we're developing the right things and that these devices are going to be the most effective. So I just want to close saying, kind of repeating what I heard in a talk, which is, let's not waste a crisis. This is our chance to look at technologies that are existing and really rethink and reimagine rehabilitation. And I encourage everybody to really reach out to people in the other field so that we can co-create and really work towards revolutionizing the field and making sure that, you know, we have the best solutions for our problems. Thank you very much.
Hello. Thank you, Camilla. That was great. I love some of those slides as well that show the complexity of dealing with some of the dilemmas that you do tackle with in Habitech especially. So we do have some time for questions. And one of the questions is, how can we inspire Queensland Health to invest in this technology, which has been well researched and is cost effective?
That is a good question. I think so far we haven't been doing a great job of reaching out to managers or insurers or, you know, people that make decisions about what is invested in. We're definitely trying to do our job of facilitating access to this type of information that we do have access to for new technologies. And I think, increasing and improving the communication, we found that that's a huge barrier.
Yeah, I think from my experience, though, since you've come on board, your connection with trying to get around and talk to a lot of the clinicians and people on the floor has been great. So I think working together to truly understand each other's needs and what is on offer and what is existing research out there, and then building that support package of evidence and identifying where there are gaps, but definitely building that support package to put to funders is worth looking at further as well. We do have another question. So I think there would be great value in having biomedical engineers watch disabled patients function in real life. Is there any way engineers and scientists are allowed in the clinical arena frontline? So I think I've just, obviously that question just came in as we were talking about it, but I've certainly had the experience of having Camilla come and spend a little time with me, which has been great. But do you want to elaborate on the potential for that?
Sure. I am also a huge advocate for that. I think also, you know, one thing that we need to talk about, which touches a little bit on what was talked today, is the upskilling of clinicians and also whether we should maybe have somebody like a biomedical engineer inside of a clinic working on these devices so that the clinicians themselves don't need to be troubleshooting or worrying about whether a device is working or not. But let's say in the current situation, non-clinical students, as far as I know, are not allowed inside of clinical settings, but we are working together with the people inside of Queensland Health to try to change that. And for sure, the support of the community and saying that, you know, we can only move together if we work together and can train not only our engineers in clinical topics, but also our clinicians to try to understand a little bit also the language and the pressures and, you know, the way engineers look at problems so that we can really effectively work more together.
Yeah, I agree completely. We do have another question. You may not have much experience obviously with the NDIS, but one of the questions was that perhaps we can help answer is, how can we overcome the NDIS's reluctance to invest in mainstream technology that are desperately needed by people with disability?
That's a great question, and we do work Habitech, I work in at Griffith, and we also have a person inside of the occupational therapy department at the spinal unit. And she did see a lot of issues running into that, especially at the beginning of COVID when people were isolated inside of the hospital and needed to communicate outside. And I think the more we do that job, also that Kyrie was saying, highlighting rehabilitation and how important it is to not only have assistive technologies that are very specific to the issues related to specific disabilities, but also at a bigger level, you know, why shouldn't you be able to have a mainstream tablet if it has voice control and that's what allows you to access the internet? We understand that and we see that as an issue, and we're definitely working to try to sensitize them or to understand these types of issues as well.
And we have had another question. Out of all the rapid movement to online and the loss of connectivity, I'm assuming with people, is there any standout factor apart from telehealth itself that has really meant that patients were able to retain wellness with early discharge and avoid readmission? And what characteristics have staff had to put to the fore during this time in working with online solutions? Well, that's a question for a number of the presenters, I think.
I was going to say, I'm not sure I can answer that question. I think definitely from all of the, if you think about the categories that Kylie presented, so therapy assistance and communication, COVID, we saw a huge increase in communication because, among other things, that was what's most accessible. But I think we can't forget that there are technologies that do address some of the other aspects. And it's really understanding how we can overcome, trying to identify the barriers of why is it that this isn't reaching the people that it needs to reach, so that we can work towards, breaking those barriers and overcoming them and being able to access them more easily.
Mm-hmm. And we've got a final question that's come in. What is the biggest challenge in working across disciplines? So in your role at the moment?
Yeah, I think it relates kind of back to where we started I think one issue that we have is we still haven't learned how to talk to each other. And there are so many stakeholders involved as well. And I think we still don't have a really good understanding from different, we've been used to kind of working in our silos instead of across disciplines, and trying to understand what the requirements are and what the pressures are for each stakeholder, and what the kind of the scope of work for each stakeholder is. We just have to try to work more in that direction. Because I think this is also a field that's so complex that you can't have one single person that understands the entire problem. You need to be working more effectively together with people that, are very good in their specialties, but that can also communicate with people from other specialties.
Fantastic. Collaboration at its best. Thank you very much, Camilla, for presenting today. I would like to bring back Dr. Tim Geraghty to round us up for this afternoon. Tim, hi. So I'll hand over to Tim.
Thank you, Brooke. I'd certainly like to thank all of our speakers this afternoon, and I'm sure you would do too. I'm not sure our system has any way of virtual clapping, but I think that's something that these systems perhaps should develop, so that we can all thank speakers the way we're used to thanking them. There were some great presentations today, really summarising the disruption that's been caused by the pandemic, but also looking very positively and thinking about how we can do things better and take advantage of some of the opportunities that the changes brought by the pandemic present. And I think that's one of the things that I would take away from today's session, and something that I'm sure many of us have been thinking about. There's been such a rapid change that we've had to go through because of the pandemic. Many new processes and procedures and technologies that we've in a way being forced to adapt in a very short, forced to uptake in a very short period of time. What I think and hope that we'll be able to do now is take a step back and take a breath and really look closely at some of those changes that have been made. No doubt some of those changes are extremely important and valuable, probably things that we should have been doing for a long time, but also thinking about parts of that that don't work as well, don't work as well for particular patient groups or particular or people with particular types of disabilities. So as we always do in healthcare and rehabilitation, try and look at now at the evidence of what works and what doesn't work as well and what we want to carry on with in the future to make rehabilitation services and management as good as it possibly can be. So thank you to all the speakers. Thank you very much to Brooke. Thank you very much to Brooke for moderating the question and answer sessions. And thank you to everyone who's joined in online today, all over the state and nationally and even internationally. It's been a pleasure to have you all here. Very strange not to be able to see people's faces. And I'm not sure about other people, but I'm still getting used to having to talk into a small camera on a computer rather than to see human faces in front of me. That's probably a skill that we'll all get better at. Also like to thank all our sponsors, the Cisco WebEx, Telica, and VBrick. This was an opportunity that came to us somewhat unexpectedly to work with Cisco, and I think that it's been a great event and a great system, and we thank them very much for their help. I'd also particularly like to mention Michaela Kerr, who's been our primary event organiser, as well as for the team of people that she's put together. But Michaela has gone above and beyond, and I think probably had to work harder to put this event together than the face-to-face event. So thank you very much, Michaela. We hope you found this session informative and really sparking some ideas, bold ideas and better solutions for the future. As I mentioned this morning, this is the first of several other events that we'll be running. I'm sure you've received information about those, and we really encourage you to join in for those as well. The next one will be on Wednesday, the 18th of November at 1:30 p.m. We will be distributing the recording of today's event if you missed any of it, and we encourage you to have a look. And the contact email address for the Hopkins Centre is there if you have any questions. So thank you all again for joining in. I hope you've enjoyed the session, and we look forward to seeing you again in a couple of weeks' time. Thanks very much.